Parlayed the Caymans, flew to Vegas just in time for the weigh-in. Fight night, MGM vaporizer blazing, ballet for the classics, trucks with armor glasses. Franchise players on a momentous occasion, announced the fact we made it. Tip a C-note to the waiters, send a bottle to your table, it's a celebration. Rolling presidential inauguration, stones clear than the HD station. And you hating, if you'd have had one that's nice, I'd have told you congratulations. I stole home base while you was tying your laces. Your bitch gave out the dugout, smoked out the clubhouse. Welcome to the majors.
Niggas hoping I get knocked off. In the studio making them drop offs. Ducking them hip hop cop cars. Sometimes my finances in the bottom of my pot jaw. Sometimes my finances in the bottom of my pot jaw.
Certified dope on three coasts. Bread healthy, we toast. Trying to see the fam wealthy. The fam held me down when I needed it. Held me up when I couldn't reach it. Flashlight when I couldn't see shit. Saying my prayers, smoking my weed, listening to raw airs. With more pull in my city than the mayor. Smart, not scared. Hide up but aware and prepared. If them fools from over there ever came round, yeah. But we'll cross that bridge when we get to it. Audio drug lord with this music.
Niggas hoping I get knocked off. In the studio making them drop offs. Ducking them hip hop cop cars. Sometimes my finances in the bottom of my pot jar.
Yeah.
Sometimes I find finances in the bottom of my pot jar.
Spit up! Yeah, don't nothing move but the decimal. Every day above ground is a chess move. Don't let the little things stress you. If you can go without killing a nigga, you successful. Low key, like I'm riding with a whole key. But I'm just chasing these cookies with this OG. I don't do first halves, I need the whole fee. You want Jada Kiss or you want the whole me?
Which one?
And I don't be popping bubbles. If I ain't house shopping, I'm at the dealer copping doubles. Ain't where I wanna be, but I'm not far. Answers at the bottom of my pot jar. Light one.
Niggas hoping I get knocked off. In the studio making them drop offs. Ducking them hip hop cop cars. Sometimes I find answers in the bottom of my pot jar.
Microphone check. Mic the microphone check. 1, 2, 1, 2. My mic sounded real nice. Levels is good. The levels is good. Yo, turn me up in the headphones. Studio shit. You feel me? Motherfucking theory of the culture. I know it's been a minute, but we back on this second. You feel what I'm saying? Your boy.
Like you never left.
Word up. DJ Mad Knox. Chiz Roundtree. Built for this network is the motherfucking station right here on Spreaker.com, iHeartRadio, Podchasers, Amazon Podcast now, Spotify Podcast, Apple Podcast, Deezer, CastBox, wherever you get in podcasting service at, go in your search engine and type in Built For This Network. You see the logo. You understand what it is and what the network is bringing, because it's for the strong and not the weak. What's going on, my brother Chiz?
I ain't shit, man. Sipping on a cold brewski. On the fuck out.
Sipping on a cold one, chilling the fuck out.
Yeah, I got a little frost on my shit.
Without further ado, I know we got some motherfucking catching up to do. It's a lot going off in the culture that's ringing off right now. You feel what I'm saying? And to start this one off, when we talk about culture and hip-hop, we got to go Big Daddy Kane, KRS-One versus. It was definitely a hip-hop concert for me, and I could probably say for you as well, Chiz.
Uh-huh.
This was like a dream, a childhood dream of ours to see this. You feel what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
It was like we got a free concert without even paying for it. I'm telling you. So, a lot of people...
They blew the roof off at Barclays.
Oh, they tore that bitch down. You feel me?
Yeah.
So, a lot of people were saying that Kane won. A lot of people saying KRS won. You had a couple of controversies between the DJs, DJ Scratch,
oh, yeah,
and DJ Kid Capri. You know what I mean? But overall, for the culture,
Ooh, Scratch.
Yeah, you know, I think it was just, I couldn't pick a winner. I'm sorry. I couldn't.
Me either. I think for that night, definitely hip hop won. Hip hop won. You know, it's both of them did their thing, man. Kane came out, showed up, showed out.
Right.
KRS did the same. It was epic, bro. It was epic.
Yeah, facts, man. Facts.
Uh-huh.
I big up these brothers, you feel what I'm saying? That.
Yeah, then they had the B-Boys out there. That's when I got excited.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
The only thing they was missing was the element of graffiti. That was
graffiti.
That was it, bro. But they, you know, hey, man, they put on a clinic, man. They really did. They bought out.
But the same thing Sway said. Cause Sway did an interview with what's her name? With Capri. And Sway was like, "Yo, where was the graffiti artist?" He was like, "That was the only thing we was missing." Cause Capri was like, "Yo." At first, Kane asked me, because he's like, "I'm real tight." But both of them, Kane and Chris. So, he's like, "Kane asked me." He's like, "Nah." And he said previously he was asked to do it 4 times before.
Right.
For the other verses. But he said, you know, he wasn't really too much before it. I guess he wanted to wait for the right opportunity. So, he said, then Chris, he's like, "Chris asked me." And he told him no at first. So, he said, more time passed. Oh, Chris asked him again. So he's like, "You know what?" He told him, "Yeah, I'd do it." So he said, at that point, I had to be Kane blessing. So I told Kane, I was like, "Yo, Chris wanted me to DJ for him. You know, I'm going to get some blessings on it." He's like, "No problem, brother, man. Like, all right." He's like, "I got Scratch already." So.
Charge in.
Right.
And Capri had a little issue with each other.
Yo, Chiz.
You know what I'm saying?
Okay, yeah, your reception was coming in real choppy. But say it again.
I didn't know at that point that Capri and Scratch had an issue with each other. I remember they did that whole DJ battle then. And he was like, he wasn't feeling that.
Yeah.
He said Kane came to him afterwards and apologized. Because Kane knew that they had a little issue, but Kane was like, "Yo, can you just, you know what I mean, let bygones be bygones, and let's, you know, let's give a good show." So, it was like, "You got it, brother, you got it."
Yeah.
He was like, Scratch was trying to, like, show his ass, and he was like, "I thought it was unprofessional."
But see, now, if you let Scratch side tell it...
Yeah, Scratch never came out and said anything, though, about it.
Yeah, but he did. Scratch was
on... He did?
Yes, he did. Scratch, I followed Scratch on IG. Scratch...
Well, he put up a personal video, or he did it on somebody else's platform?
Oh, he put it up on his platform, on his Instagram. It was a 13-minute video. And the way he explained it, like... Kid Capri grabbed the mic and did some, like, freestyling type shit. Like, he rapped. And I'm thinking about what he did Kid Capri did do that. So he said, like, at the end of the day, okay, Kid Capri is KRS-One. If you want to go, he said, let's treat this like boxing. Kid Capri is KRS-One's trainer. I'm Big Daddy Kane's trainer. Okay, you let the boxers box. Kid Capri grabs the mic as a trainer, as a DJ, says a couple of bars. Now, I feel like at this point, they trying to jump Kane. You feel what I'm saying? Because the rhyme that was like, it was a sublime towards Kane. So now, what he said, what I did, now I'm thinking, okay, if he's going to do that, I'm going to come in and help Kane out. You feel what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I'm not going to sit there and let my boy get jumped by these two and me just sitting back not doing shit. You feel what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So at the end of the day, that's when he got on his shit and was like, yo, let's take this to the motherfucking DJ battle and shit. You feel what I'm saying? Because at the
end,
he felt like, why would you sit there and spit rhymes and it's supposed to be Big Daddy Kane versus KRS-One? It wasn't no... When I thought about when he said that, I said, he did go and spit a couple of bars. But I didn't know the bars he said was subliminal towards Kane, though.
I didn't peep that.
That much, but Scratch... on point was like, yo, he shouldn't have never did that, period. Like, if you did a DJ,
play your position.
He's like, that's the only reason why he jumped and went on a ledge like he did, because Kid Capri did that bullshit with the ramen. So he felt like they was trying to get at Kane on some two-on-one type shit, and he wasn't trying to rock like that.
So what you're telling me is that happened first with Capri.
I believe so.
But I'm trying to get the timeline in my head.
I watched the video so many times, and it is slipping my mind right now. But it did happen before Scratch got on his bullshit, though. It did. That's why I said, I do recollect Kid Capri saying some shit on the mic, because I was looking at it like, well, why he saying that? You feel what I'm saying? So that kind of informed me, like, okay, I kind of feel Scratch on that. He had his guys back. You feel what I'm saying?
Like, so at that point, Scratch like, fuck that shit.
Yeah, because now if you don't know what's going on and you DJing, but you hear your opponent's DJ sitting there going in at least on four bars and don't know where the fuck that come from, because, you know, that wasn't even part of the show. Now you feel like, wait a minute, what's going on here? Like a Jadakiss, what are we doing here? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So now it's like, yo, okay, what do you do at that point? Do you sit the fuck back, or do you go and ride for your dog? And I can't be mad at Scratch for doing that, bro. I can't.
Yeah.
If that's what Scratch...
He had to make a drastic move.
Exactly. And if that was motherfucking Scratch plan to motherfucking, you know, get it done and shit, I'm not mad at that whole shit right there.
So them niggas really got something going on with each other.
I see this stem from past beef before, and what Kid Capri was saying on the Sway interview, I guess, you know, he got mad about somebody calling him the best DJ in the world or something like
that. Yeah. Capri was like, yo, I didn't give myself that name. He's like, the people gave me that name.
Right. And then it also goes back to when, during the pandemic, when, remember when a lot of the DJs was putting up their Cash App and stuff like that, Kid Capri was you know, because Scratch was like, yo, support your DJs that's coming on these Instagrams and giving these cash at, because, you know, they got bills to pay. Some of them work.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah.
And probably
wasn't getting no gigs at that point. Like, you wasn't smart with your money beforehand. You was kind of fucked up.
You wasn't getting shit, right. So at the end of the day, Scratch was bigging up that level of, yo, help the DJs out.
I remember that, because you think there ain't no 401k for DJs, ain't no retirement plan.
Right. Capri felt like that shit was like, not what's up. Not that, you know what I mean? For you to just sit there and put your cash app while you doing the set, it's like, it takes the, like, the integrity out on DJing and shit. You feel what I'm saying?
I don't think nothing wrong with that. See, everybody ain't got money like Capri. Or, you know, it's other DJs that's not, you know, not fortunate enough to have the finances like Capri got.
And
Capri done did shows all around the world all year round.
Right. And see, that's what Scratch Point was. Scratch Point was like, if you don't have certain people that don't have the big household names like a Capri or a Scratch, but locally they just rocking in certain clubs, certain strip clubs to get they pay their bills. Cause that's when Khaled and Envy started the whole what's that fundraiser for the DJs? You know what I mean? So
because at that point. Everybody ain't got money also like Khaled or Envy, because you know Envy is in some real estate, real heavy. So he's getting paid regardless.
Yeah. So it was just one of them things that, okay, he Kid Capri said, when I think the beef stemmed from a little bit of that, but they talked about it. You know what I mean? I guess they squashed it or whatever.
It don't seem like it was squashed.
But to Scratch offense, Scratch was going from what the protocol of the show, what they wanted to do. You feel what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And he said it was a lot of shit scratched out of the show that they didn't even do. You feel what I'm saying? Like Chris only did one freestyle. It was supposed to be three freestyles a piece between Kane and motherfucking what's your name? But Chris only did one. You feel what I'm
one,
saying?
One, yeah.
So it was like the program was like changing on the fly type shit. So when
they was calling audibles, there was a lot of audibles being called.
So when Capri did that shit with the mic, that's when Scratch felt like he had to go in and save his guy. So, you know,
I'm gonna tell you this much: Scratch did the goddamn thing.
Oh yeah, oh yeah.
He showed up and showed out. So I think he went low below the turntables and came back up with that mask and shit. I'm like, oh shit.
Cause he was ready. He was ready to go win. And that's when Kane said, "Nah, don't do it." Cause remember, he had his sneaker ready to do his set on a Scratch shit. And Kane was like, nah, don't do it. So Kane backed him off of Kid. You feel what I'm saying? You gotta think about it. Like, Scratch was ready to go. He was ready to go.
Yeah. He wanted all the smoke.
Right. So, hey, bro, it's crazy, man. Yo.
But you know what? That whole debacle, that I think that just added to the excitement of the whole event. Okay, you got Scratch. You got Scratch DJing for Kane. You got Capri DJing for Chris.
Right.
And they don't necessarily see eye to eye. So, you know, hey, I think that like, basically added more wood to the fire.
Right.
And I think that, you know, that it was a lot of great moments, man. Like I was saying, the B-Boys came out. Shit, they was break dancing and popping and locking. He had crazy legs. Almost everybody was there, nice and smooth. I said, oh, shit. Nice and smooth?
Yo, it was crazy.
The one that wasn't there was Cool G Rap. Because they asked Cool G Rap to come, but he didn't want to come, you know.
Due to probably personal reasons.
It had to be. It had to be.
It definitely was personal. But shout out to Roxanne Shante. Shout out.
Oh, yeah. That was dope. But yeah, that shit. I mean, it was a legendary night, though, man. It just, we had two hip-hop pioneers, two legendary DJs. So, they brought almost everybody out. But, you know, with the Kool G rap again, I'm like, damn, that would have been sick. Imagine if Kool G would have popped out.
Yo, but shout out to Mad Lion. Shout out to Nice and Smooth.
And Mad Lion, yeah.
Shout out to Buckshot Shorty.
Buckshot Shorty, yeah.
It still turned out to be great regardless, man. So,
yeah. Everybody was in the building. It was
Daz Effect.
Buster.
Yeah.
Everybody was there. Swiss had on his BDP leather jacket, the leather pants. I'm like, oh shit.
Yeah, it was.
Cause you know he rapping for that Bronx shit.
It was crazy, man. It was crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And speaking
because what Swiss was like, I think they was trying to have it in Madison Square, but I don't think Madison Square gave him the green light. So he was like, we got a new partnership with Barclay. So I'm figuring any future ones that they do from any type of New York artist will probably be at the Barclay instead of Madison Square now.
Right.
I don't know what happened. Was it some type of... What was the last battle at Madison Square was with Fat Joe and Ja Rule. So... Was something happening there afterwards or the fight?
I don't know, man. I think.
Why would they not give them the green light?
I don't, but it's all about money, Chiz. Like, at the end of the day, it's all about money.
Yeah.
And then you got to remember basketball season is back. So.
Oh, yeah. Busy with that. Yeah. Okay.
If you're bumping, trying to bump heads along with when these games is popping off, you feel what I'm saying? Now you gotta maneuver some shit around. You feel what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, the Garden is gonna definitely charge you. You know what I mean?
Oh, hell yeah.
So the situation is they gonna charge you. So if Swiss and them looking at this shit like a business, they probably like, nah.
And that's exactly what they looking at it like.
Right. You feel what I'm saying? But speaking of my fucking battles, man, shout out to D Greatest. Saint Rough
Buck
had a recent battle, and
oh yeah, that shit was dope. Pretty dope ass battle, you know. And then I was listening afterwards; it got a little bit heated.
Yeah, and I'm gonna tell
you, people was going back and forth with each other, not on no, you know, crazy, like no street shit, but especially on people's choices of songs, and like you gotta play shit for the people, like you can't go for what you like, because what you like,
I think,
may be totally different from what the people like.
I think, bottom line, that was, see, my whole thing is a lot of people gotta remember. The key word in this shit is battle.
Battle.
You know what I'm saying? It's battle. Like, understand is a couple of B and C side records that you might be cool with on your personal well-being. Maybe you're a podcaster or a DJ and you feel like this is always a vibe or a hit on your show. That does not go in the same energy when you're in the battle. You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah. Because who was that? That was Ross that played Busta Rhymes Decisions?
No, that was the Saint.
Saint. Yeah, I didn't think that was a good... You know, I love that song, but for this particular battle, no. I disagree with that one.
That was a personal... thing that Saint felt like he played on his show is rocking on your show. You might get people in your room that love that music, but in the case of a battle? No. And I'm going to tell you, on that particular song, that's on the Busta Rhymes Back on My Bullshit album. He had a choice of A-Rab Money and Respect My Conglomerate. And a couple, is two, three more.
He had a few other choices.
He had, if he would have came with one of them, A-Rab Money or Respect My Conglomerate, he would have got it off. You feel what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But again, I you know, hearing the after show, Saint was like, he's staying on his list and everything else. And
yeah, he was saying that. And you know, salute to them brothers, because I think after he played that, I think Ruff came back with Lil Wayne, a Millie, I believe.
Let me, I'm gonna keep this straight 1,000, and I know a Saint, I love you, brother, but you got slaughtered, bro. You got your ass whooped. Let's keep it all the way. I'm not trying to PC this shit all the way around. You didn't come in that motherfucking battle ready. The two short one you started off with was great. You should have kept it on that same energy. Even when you had an Ice Cube record, out of all the Ice Cube records, you picked something where Ice Cube is talking about somebody dying. That's not good for a battle, Saint. It's not good. You feel what I'm saying?
See, me, I would have played like No Vaseline or some shit, like making statements.
No, but see, you gotta understand the year. He played a Cube record. In the 2000s. You feel what I'm saying?
No.
You gotta brother, listen to me. It's a lot of, and I know you ride for your coast, Saint. Shout out to the whole West Coast. My thing is, you got cats like Mac Dre. You got cats like Q. You got Dre. You got Snoop. You got Short. You got 40 Water. You got all these people.
Mm-hmm.
Rock with Kendrick, The Game. You feel what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
West Coast Connection. I'm missing some names, but my whole thing is, you could have had a same energy as Ruff if you'd have went on some real street shit. You feel what
I don't think Saint was on point with that.
He started off great with the show.
He started off, yeah.
That's the energy he should have been standing on right there.
His momentum kind of went down.
Right.
Due to his song picks.
Right. He could have went, and then at this point, you could have went a Mac Dre. You could have went a 40 Water. You could have went with anybody, especially in the 80s. 80s was all basically damn near all short in the 80s a little bit.
That's what I'm saying.
You feel what I'm saying? So you could have, and short got, you could have held the 80s down with just Short catalog alone. You could have held down the 80s. You feel what I'm saying? And then went into your 90s with probably like your NWAs, your Dre's, your old whoever. You feel what I'm saying? Bro, you could have.
You gotta be strategic.
My thing is, understand, people, this is a hip hop battle. You feel what I'm saying? This is not a slow jam battle where you could kind of get them B, C, and D records off based on that. No, this is.
It wasn't the place for that.
Bro, even if you go back to my battle, I played a couple of B side records. But my B-side records is what people actually knew
it was
in the
hard.
Chat room.
Yeah. Right. You heard J-Fish. I think J-Fish wants some more smoke with you.
I'm cool with J-Fish wanting more smoke with me. I sit in the smoking section. I am a smoker myself. You feel what I'm saying?
I
am one of the presidents of the 420 room. You feel what I'm saying? So wanting to smoke is nothing to me. I wear my crown. I stand on my crown. Multiple crowns heavy. You feel what I'm saying?
Talk that shit.
It's nothing to me. I don't care who want the smoke. with Mad Knox, I will supply the motherfucking weed and the motherfucking woods or whatever you smoke with, and let's get this smoking section popping. Let's have a smoke-a-dawn. You feel what I'm saying?
While we saying that, this is a PSA for the greatest. I want some smoke, too. Line me up with anybody.
Line them up. See,
I'm paying attention. I'm paying attention.
Bruh, anybody from the Built for This Network bloodline, we don't back down for nothing. I'm going to talk my shit for my crew right now. You feel what I'm saying? Anybody from the Built for This Network bloodline is not scared of nobody. You got to understand that. We come from a cloth, a bloodline where we want all the smoke. We in before the shits. We for the shits. Understand that. So
lionhearted.
You feel what I'm saying? So whatever, whoever, and whenever anybody want to battle me and my crew, understand we going to rep to the motherfucking death of us.
Set it up, yo, the greatest. Set it up. Set it up, the greatest.
Set it up. You feel what I'm saying?
All I want is a date.
But to my brother the Saint, bro, listen, if you come with a next season of a hip-hop battle, go in your catalog, bro. Go in.
Uh-huh.
You said prior to this, you got a bunch of records that you want to do. Bro, go with, sometimes you got to go with the hits. Sometimes you got to go with major B-sides. But far as these C and D records that you played on this battle, it's not a go, bro.
It
wasn't hitting. It's not going to hit. You feel what I'm saying? So
it wasn't hitting.
Real shit.
Ruff was on his ass.
No, shout out to Ruff. Shout out to Ruff.
Mm-hmm.
Shout out to Ruff. Like, Ruff, you know, even if Ruff probably Google his list, hell, at the most part, it was golden. It worked out. Even if he Googled his list or whatever. And Ruff would tell you straight, he said in the comments, he's not a DJ, he's a golfer. But at the end of the day, Ruff know what's going on out in these streets. And see, that's the thing, too. Y'all got to be versatile into y'all regions. You feel what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
That's another thing where Saint fell on that. Even though he picked Busta Rhymes, he's an East Coast artist, he has to go in and understand, okay, what was popping in that East Coast time of a Busta Rhymes when you picking that type of album for Busta? What was the hottest single? What was the hottest hit? Okay, Busta came out with Back On My Bullshit in maybe 2012, 13?
Okay. Yeah, 12, yeah.
What was the ring off? What was the ring off that people love? A-Rab Money. Okay.
How did A-Rab Money?
You could have went that or Respect My Conglomerate with Jada.
Yeah, either one.
You would have been great. That's what I'm saying. You know what I mean? So understand, people, when you're going into these battles, keyword is battle. You're out to get a motherfucking win. It's your playlist.
You're out for blood.
It's your playlist versus the other person's playlist. It's basically a versus of us, but we not no motherfucking MCs or rappers or whatever the case may be. But
yeah, it's a song selection.
It's song selection, you know? And it's letting your list speak for you. When I went in with Jay Fish, I went into the shit as a motherfucker that, like, yo, all the records that I pick, I'm making a statement with. All the MC I pick, I'm making a statement with. You feel what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I stood on. You know what I mean? Even on the MC Light, Stop Looking, Listen. A lot of people could give me a backlash for that. But if you really listen to her lyrics, listen to her lyrics, she's talking that motherfucking talk. You feel what I'm saying? Okay, yeah. The LL won over that. Great. LL was a bigger record than Stop Looking, Listen. I get it. I'm not mad at
you. Yeah.
But
do we understand that?
Understand. I went in there talking my shit as, like, MC Light was representing what I was feeling at that time. You feel what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. All the other lists that I played stood a test of that time. You feel what I'm saying? So you got to understand that. If you're a podcaster or a DJ who play music, do not go in this battle thinking, okay, I could just get over with what I play with on my show because the chat room will like that. Don't go in that. Go in the mindset of you're going to, like you said, you going with your playlist set and you going to annihilate your opponent. You have to go in there, though.
This is chess, not checkers.
Yo, for real. But other than that, shout out to, you know what I mean? It was a rough. Shout out to you, my brother. You came in, did what you had to do. Ralph
got that KO.
Saint, you did what you had to do. I just think you just picked. You had the right idea of artists that you wanted, but I think your selection of songs was wrong. Like, if you were picking Cube in the 2000s, I'm not mad at you picking Cube in the 2000s. I just think your choice of a song for picking Cube in that 2000 was not it.
Yeah, his execution was off.
And that's what I'm saying.
So you have to see, it's one thing strategizing, but you got to be able to execute strategy.
And know your opponent. And this is my thing. Jay Fish is from Brooklyn. Jay Fish listens to rap. He listens to hip hop. Hell, he played music on his show. So for the most part, I know personally where Jay Fish, okay, he's born in Brooklyn, resides in Atlanta. At the end of the day, I know he's going to go with a little bit of the South, and I know he's going to go with a little bit of the East Coast. I knew this going in there already.
You had to do your homework on Fish.
I really didn't, because I knew from Jay Fish been doing podcasts for some years now. This is what he does. He plays a couple of hip-hop joints on his show. And then he goes in on a break. He might pull out a little bit of Three Stacks or something like that. So I already knew his element of awareness of music. You feel what I'm saying?
So it's pretty expensive.
Bruh, I knew I had to come in there on some, not only being a DJ type shit, but give him some motherfucking singers so my motherfucking list can speak that shit. That's why when D Great said, yo, y'all want to call in for the battle, I let the chat room know every song that I pick is making a statement for me of what I would pick to J Fish if I was an MC and we was battling.
So you now, stood on that.
Right. So now when the audience listen, oh shit, Nas come with Shook Ones Part 2. He come with Time for Some Action. He comes with Ambition as a Rider. He letting Jay Fish know what he stand on. You feel what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's my mindset. You gotta go in there like that. I don't wanna keep dragging on to the subject because I know we got more to talk about, but you know, that's what I stand on. And to the future,
you gotta shake the room up.
Bruh, you gotta know who your opponent is. You gotta know your opponent and know what they're capable of doing. Bottom line. You feel what I'm saying? So, hey, man, listen. But, man, I'm gonna tell you, Jay-Z is doing a lot of moves out here, bro.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Jay-Z is doing a lot of moves out here. His name,
he's in the shadows. He's in the shadows doing his motherfucking thing.
Hey, they got the Harder They
that's,
Fall.
That's the puppet master.
The Harder They Fall press. They did.
Oh yeah, I seen that. Yeah,
bruh, that thing is gonna ring on Netflix. The soundtrack that he put together, brother, is they just said is amazing for that shit, bro. You feel what I'm saying? So, hey, shout out the whole. Young Jeezy is doing the Uncensored where he mentioned Hov. They got into a little, not him and Hov got into a little scuffle, but they were side by side scuffling. You know what I mean?
And he was like, Hov, I read that one. He's like, Hov got hands.
Yeah, he said, I respect Hov for that. Like, Hov stood next to him. You know what I mean? Even Meek Mill was like, yo, I never seen the check from my label, but Hov was there to hold me down on a lot of shit. You feel what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
So, hey, bro, shout out. A lot of people could say they want to buy Hov, but guess what? This Dr. Dre halftime show wouldn't have happened.
Oh, yeah.
Never sacrificed what he sacrificed. And that's from the word of Snoop Dogg from his interview.
Oh, on Breakfast Club. Breakfast Club interview.
He said he shouted out Jay-Z for being the motherfucking lamb and putting himself out there for this halftime show.
Because you know Snoop got a new album coming out.
Algorithm. That's coming out November 12th. That thing is going to be, bro. He said it's like a compilation album. You know what I mean? But, yo, he said he got a lot.
And then he got the new role on Def Jam.
Yeah.
I think executive, creative, consultant, something like that.
Yeah. He getting that money.
He said, I didn't want to come on as an artist. He was like, I want to come on to help other artists. Because he was like growing up. He said, we all wanted to be on Def Jam.
Yeah.
He was like a lot of people on Def Jam were our idols. LL, Run DMC. He's like, all them motherfuckers was our idols.
Yeah. So, hey, bro, listen to me.
And you know what? Condolences, because his mother passed away,
yeah,
too.
I was getting ready to say that. Like, you know what I mean? He definitely being strong, bro. For real.
Yeah, it's a lot. It takes a lot to still be able to handle business like that at that type of level with grieving over the loss of your mother. Right. This ain't just no regular person. This is your mom.
Hey, yo,
I believe his mother was 70 years old.
You heard? Yeah. His mother taught him a lot, man. Taught him a lot. Yes, she did, man. And you could see the actual spirit in him.
Yeah. Snoop is one of the icons, OG status.
Yeah. He definitely legendary. You know what I mean? And shout out to Snoop.
Oh, he turned 50 too. It was his birthday.
Yeah. Shout out to him on that too. Happy birthday, Snoop. But also, I didn't know fucking Daz, him, and Corrupt help pen Warren G's album and shit.
Oh, yeah, I didn't know that either.
That shit was, yo, just to protect him from Suge Knight, that was crazy.
Uh-huh. Yeah, because you got to think, all of them knew how Suge was. Yeah. All of them knew how Suge was. And they didn't want Warren exposed to that. Yeah. And I didn't know this either. He was like, I think Charlamagne asked him about the money. And he was like, at that time, I was fighting my murder case. And he's like, we clearly spent almost like $10
million.
Right. Because at the time, they was using technology. They was like the first to use technology like that for all these cases. It was like a good amount of money was spent. So he's like, that's why I didn't really walk away with a lot of money from Death Row. But people would think he did, and he sold a lot, but he really didn't.
I think it's super dope, too, that he got his wife as a manager, bro.
Yeah, because he was like a lot of artists. Something happened to them, you know, that he had these people that don't have that don't have the right mind and right heart. Take control of their catalog, be real. He's like, I'd rather have my wife, my kids, my grandkids. And he said he got 7 grandkids.
No, he got 6.
Six. Yeah. Okay, 6. I'm like, wow.
Nah, real
shit. I knew he had some grandkids, but I didn't know that many.
Yeah.
I mean, Snoop was dropping a lot of game.
Oh yeah, that's what he's there for. He's there to give, like you said, to give him that.
And that's what he said himself.
Yeah.
He said information. He said I have to give the information.
Yeah. So
that, you think about it, that's what it's all about, man. Like, you know, you going through something, you learning, and you passing it on to the next person.
That's it.
Don't be selfish with the game. Spread the game.
And he,
at that point, everybody could flourish.
Right. he kind of broke down the independent versus major thing.
Oh, I heard that part too. Yeah,
that made sense to me when he said it, because a lot of people, you know, we, like you said, we love independency, but independency only take you to a certain level. A major gets global. You know what I mean? Look, so
you could be a mega star,
right? If you're looking at it from a standpoint like that, then I get it. I get it.
Because you look at it like this: imagine artists like Cardi B. Imagine if she was independent. Do you think she would be big as she is right now?
No, she would definitely be slept on. She'd hit the scene, but she wouldn't be the megastar she is now. No.
Yeah, because she got that big machine behind her.
Right, right. I agree with that.
Unlimited budget.
But before she had that machine, she was making a buzz, though, with her mixtape.
Yeah, she was. I think that was her whole plan.
Right. And then she got she built relationships. Like,
that's what it's all about.
If you think about her stripping in and sues and shit, all the rappers who used to go there and whatnot, you know what I mean? She started building new relationships. So when she came on, a lot of the rappers already knew who she was based off the strip club scene. You know what I mean?
She had to earn her
stripes and put it up to the top. You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So,
you know, a lot of artists, they strive to do the independent thing and stand on that. Some, they do the independent thing just to gain some leverage. And like you said, build relationships and eventually get into a major.
Right.
It just depends on your aim. You know, what you want. What you really want for your career.
Exactly. Exactly.
That all depends on, I think, you know, it's, objectable. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, it just depends.
That's why I said it's, I kind of feel what Roc Nation is doing with, like,
yeah, me too. Artists,
because what they doing, they giving the artists ownership of their shit, but they just standing behind them on a level of distribution. You know what I mean?
Like,
being that solid.
And they getting them endorsement deals.
All that,
because Roc Nation got their hands in a lot of different shit, bro.
And everything. That's real shit.
From sports to big brands like Coca-Cola, Pepsi. You see Jay-Z got deals with goddamn NFL. All types of crazy shit.
That's what I'm saying. If it wasn't for Jay-Z doing what he did with that sit down, do you think... Now the Super Bowl is in LA this year. So do you think they would have came to a Dr. Dre, one of the pillars of LA, you feel what I'm saying, to do a halftime show? I don't think so.
No. Because even during the Snoop interview, Charlamagne was like, he heard something that it was either between them and somebody else. And Snoop was like, what? It's like, nah, it can't get no better than us in L.A.
He's being absolutely right.
Yeah. He said, it don't get no better than that.
He's being...
That Dre is so laser-focused about this Super Bowl performance.
Hey, man, we gonna see what happened. February is right around the corner. So, we definitely going to see what happened. I want to get into another one, too, before we go on a commercial break real quick. Shout out to Eve Brandy and what's her name? Eve Brandy,
Tori Norton, I think her name is.
Tori Norton. And
somebody else.
Yeah, I don't know who she really is, but they got the thing called Queens on.
It
comes on 8.
They just did an interview on Breakfast Club, I think, before this, I think before this new one.
Right. Shout out to Eve. She pregnant. Congratulations to her.
Oh, shit.
Expecting her first child.
She got something in the oven.
Yeah. But at the end of the day, the show is two episodes in, man. I watched it. I kind of like it, bro. It's about the...
I didn't get into it yet.
Oh, man, you got to check. If anybody got ABC, it comes on channel... Well, for us, Chiz, it's channel 7, ABC up here in Jersey. It comes on Tuesdays at 10:30 at night. You feel what I'm saying? But
yeah.
You can check it out. On if you got ABC on demand and shit like that, you could probably just, or if you got a Fire Stick, you could probably search it up. It's called Queens. It's about there was a group back in the 90s, you know what I mean? They went through trials and tribulations, and now they're trying to make a comeback for it. But like always, there's some drama in the mix of the comeback. You feel what I'm saying? So it's really dope. It got a great storyline to it. You know what I mean? Shout out to Swiss is actually the executive music producer on that. You feel
Swiss is a motherfucking mastermind.
Yeah, he's the executive. They got the single out called Nasty Girls and shit. That's surging iTunes and stuff like that. So yeah, and Brandy actually, she's singing, but she also rapping. You know what I mean? So Brandy is not only singing, but she's spitting bars, brother. So
yeah, you know what? I was looking at her Instagram videos. She been doing a lot of videos with Cameron and shit. She be rapping and stuff. I'm like, okay, Brandy got a little flow.
And Cameron is in the second episode. Cameron.
So they was on set. It seemed like they was in some type of dressing room doing these videos.
Cameron has a actual role in that shit. So it's not no, okay, Cameron just on the episode and out. It's a story. Cam got a storyline with Brandy going through that shit, bro.
Oh, okay. I was trying to make sense of it because I seen the little Instagram videos they was making.
Nah, Cam got a storyline going through that shit. So that's that.
See, Cam's smart, man. See, he makes a lot of moves.
Nah, no doubt, no doubt. Cam bust these moves, bro. He came. It was a song. Actually, I don't want to give too much away. But this motherfucker came out in a pink mink and shit that reminded me of old 2000 Dipset and shit. I was like, damn, bro. That shit was crazy.
Because you got to think, when he first came out with that shit was cold as hell. Who the hell is wearing a pink mink with the pink hat? I need to have a pink Range Rover. Yo, this nigga is different.
Yeah, he is.
Illegal. For sure. All of them.
Since we are the best, yo, you agree with me, right? We gonna go to a quick musical break. Come right back with the next 30 minutes. And give me the culture show. Cause we ain't no motherfucking culture show. Your boy Knox. Cheers. Let's go.
Just respect my conglomerate. Just respect my conglomerate.
It's Boss Rhyme. And I'm back with the crack and the thugs and the drugs. Nigga, black. The best to do it, we only deal with the facts, bitch. Blazing and I'm so amazing on the tracks, bitch. And I jump and I skip and I hop and I flip over niggas like gymnastics. Watch the way I come and I'm giving the streets acid. Bastards, niggas know I'm the king of the classics. Drastic pressures, I'm spreading like a rash, bitch. Clashes in session, you're about to get your ass kicked. Emperor of every round table of the house. And when I speak, niggas respect me as leader of the councilman. God rap. God persona, God thriller, God body in the flesh, call me Godzilla. Now I know you see we be the most prominent, dominant niggas, respect my conglomerate.
Since we are the best and you agree with me, right? No need to debate. The way we push shit. See, we're kinda like the government, so just respect my conglomerate. Just respect my conglomerate. Just respect my conglomerate. Just respect my conglomerate.
Alright, buzz.
Just respect my conglomerate.
Young Money in charge. Yes, it's Lil Wayne, but the money's in large. Priorities, Young Money in God. Now they wanna know how I be getting money on Mars. Cause I be getting paid like out of this world. Hip hop is a bitch and I'm proud of this girl. But when the sharks come see how the fish curl, this is my game, you gon' need a referral. I know more about tree than squirrel. Me don't talk much, but that heat's so verbal. Brand new Mark Jacob Pico thermal. Gun outside of the gear external. I'm so fly, y'all still at the terminal. I put you in a dirt jib because I see the worm in you. Dirt is out, bitch. Admire and acknowledge it. And respect my conglomerate.
Since we are the best and you agree with me, right? No need to debate. The way we bomb shit. Yeah. See, we're kinda like the government. So just respect my conglomerate. Just respect my conglomerate. Just respect my conglomerate. Just respect my conglomerate. Just respect my conglomerate.
Yo, workers, bosses, Ferraris, cautious, dope fiends, nauseous, crack spots, losses, racetrack horses, big meetings at the round table. What the cost is, money, changes, yeah. Devils, angels, we the ones who say what you can and what you can't do, respect, power, kush, sour, haze, airy, pills, powder, gangsters, garments, ice, garments, dawn shit, real niggas who I get it on with, when I'm around my colleagues ain't comfortable, they all gotta sit with my verses for a month or two, wrong nigga to have a problem with, the blade first and the bullet gon' follow it, yeah, if you're lucky I might hollow it,
we are back, we are back, we are back right here. Theory of the Culture Show, Cheers Round Street. Your boy Earl Jones. Your boy Earl Jones. It's taking, still taking a leave of absence right now due to the passing away of his brother. And like I said, on the last episode of Theory of the Culture, we gonna get that brother all the time. He need to get his mind right. You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah. He all right though, y'all. He all right. He just trying to, you know, put the pieces back together in the proper perspective, you know.
I'm going to tell you what, because mental health is a major thing. Not only, I can say the human race, period. You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I know as black people, we prideful as fuck. You feel what I'm saying? But as your mental health should be key on a lot of things on how you move out here just in life. You feel what I'm saying? Because my
exactly. Is
if your mind ain't right, your mic ain't right. You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah. Ain't nothing wrong with, you know, taking a break, you know, getting a little me time, yeah. You know, that's what they call it. Yeah, you know,
sometimes you burn the battery so much you need to sit back and recharge yourself. Take a week off, recharge yourself. Like, you know what I mean? Like, my thing is, even with DJing, okay, I could bring a Friday show every Friday, but I don't, you know, after I burn myself out and I feel like, yo, I'm playing a lot of music and it's sometimes the same music. You feel what I'm saying? I have to sit back and recharge myself. I might take a week off. Might go in digging for new records that people haven't heard in a while, or something new, or whatever the case may be to play.
Yeah, but you got to refresh yourself.
You got to refresh yourself, man. So ain't nothing wrong with taking a leave of absence for a radio show or even a job. You feel what I'm saying? If you can,
ain't nothing wrong with it.
If you got sick days, if you got personal days, and you want to take a day off, brother, do it. I'm not saying, you know, if you need to do it. My thing is, make sure your mental health is right. Bottom line, that's my And, you know, we're going to keep our brother Jones in prayers and the whole Jones family in prayers as well. You know what I mean? But, yeah, man, speaking of mental health and everything else and what's going on in this world, I know, Chiz, you wanted to bring up the Dave Chappelle.
Yeah, man, the clothes are, oh my God, it was such a great comedy. It wasn't really comedy. It was like, it was something different. Like, he was like really, he was like Richard Pryor on, where he was just just bringing up shit. Like, he really put the LGBTQT, whatever the fuck, sorry if I fucked it up, that community on blast. Because a lot of times, you know, you can't do or say nothing against them. They will, what they say, the cancel culture, they will cancel you.
Right.
As soon as you say anything. And he put them on blast.
Like they
But also said that,
yeah,
you know, one of his friends was a transgender. And she died. She killed herself, matter of fact, committed suicide.
Right.
And he was like, it broke his heart. He was telling the whole spiel on the stage.
Right.
You know, and it was great, man. It was great. It was great on Netflix. You got to watch it.
No, it definitely was great. They, you know, I guess a lot of transgenders took offense to it.
Yeah.
Especially.
They trying to cancel him, but you can't. But the whole thing is, Netflix is standing behind him. Because they wanted Netflix to pull it.
To a certain extent, because I'm going to tell you why. Because the Netflix workers who was transgenders or whatever, they did a walkout.
Okay. Yeah, I heard about that.
So they did a walkout, they did a march in the sense of pulling the Chappelle show. Now, during this walkout, it's like, okay, you can do that, but what are you going to prove? At the end of the day, like you said, the owner's going to stand behind him. They gave this motherfucker some money to put out this special. Okay?
Yeah, like over $40 million.
Okay? So at the end of the day, you think Netflix ain't trying to recoup that money back? Based on how
you shitting me.
You feel what I'm saying? Like, okay, regardless of the fact of the situation, and I he probably do hear y'all, he probably understand y'all, but at the end of the day, he is a business man. You feel mm-hmm. what I'm saying? If I'm giving Dave Chappelle $30-40 million for a special and pay them that, guess what I'm trying to get back on the back end? Another $40-50 million.
You yeah.
know what I mean?
It's all about making profit.
And which he probably already did. You feel what I'm saying?
Because what this, like, his fourth or fifth special
right.
for Netflix.
Which he probably did when it dropped. But now that the controversy is behind it, you just surpassed his point. You feel what I'm saying? So,
mm-hmm.
so you made a fuss about this, trying to get them all. But now, when you put controversy behind the shit, guess what the general public is going to do? They're going to go on to Netflix to see what Dave Chappelle said wrong. Which, guess
yeah,
what?
Yeah, what are you talking about?
Right. Which, guess what? It equals a stream from a person who really didn't see the Chappelle special. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So, if a motherfucking average Joe didn't like Dave Chappelle or how he do comedy or whatever, okay? Now you got this big global look of the LGBTQT?
LGBTQABCDFG
community sitting here saying Dave Chappelle said this about us on that Netflix special and we don't want to stand behind it. Okay, what did he say? Now mm-hmm. you got the average Joe who don't like Dave Chappelle. Guess what they going to do? They going to go on Netflix. They going to stream the whole series just to see what Dave Chappelle said. And probably
what are you talking about?
But guess what Netflix is thinking? Okay, you can do that, but thank you for the stream. Thank you for mm-hmm. the awareness. Thank you for the free promotion. Because that's mm-hmm. how the hell... It kind of reminds me of Straight Outta Compton. Remember when they was trying to protest NWA for being in the stores and all these people went and bought the NWA CD and they sat in there and they stomped it, they ran it over and all
this Oh, yeah. shit.
And Eazy-E said something that made motherfucking sense to me. They was like, yo, Q was like, yo, I can't believe they stomping our shit. Eazy-E said, I don't give a fuck. They had to sit there and pay for these motherfuckers. So Easy was winning.
It's paid for already.
Right. Easy was winning. Because guess what?
It's already money in the bank.
You could do all that protesting shit at the end of the day, but guess what? You paid fucking $15, $16 and fed my family off that shit. So,
yeah. So you would stomp it, throw it out your car window.
All that shit.
Spit so, on it.
That's what I'm saying. So for all these people who didn't see the Chappelle show, now they doing the march, oh, we walking out, and now it's getting this global attention. Now guess what? Other people from the average people who never seen the show, they gonna go and watch the Chappelle show.
They gonna stream it.
And now guess what the stream sales do? Where you're generating, where Netflix generated maybe, you know, because it's Dave Chappelle, you're gonna get your average black audience or whatever the case may be. But now you got a whole community that you rah-rahed with and felt like they offended about you and want to cancel you. Now you made them sales boost up even more.
Because controversy sells.
So guess what? At the end of the day, the owner of Netflix, he can sit there and be like, oh, I understand you guys, how you feel. It's not right. Everything else. But in the meantime, between time, you just gave this motherfucker free promotion.
Yeah.
To stream the Chappelle show.
It's a mindfuck shit.
Right.
Like, okay, y'all can get all hyped up, get all upset, but y'all helping us out.
Thank you for the promotion. Thank you for the stream.
Thank you.
Thank you for all. Now, what we ejected on streaming, what we ejected for Dave to do, has tripled that based off the controversy behind it.
Uh-huh.
You feel what I'm saying? So who are you hurting at the end of the day?
Who? And Dave is smart. Dave is smart because he knew with this whole special that he was going to stir the pot.
Right. But who, at the end of the day, you hurting yourself in your pockets, because now you walked off on a job that's probably fucking feeding your family or doing whatever it's doing. You feel what I'm saying? You walked out on that shit trying to make a stand. So now you fucked up your pay based on somebody else's statement of how they feel. This is America, supposedly. This is supposed to be.
And people, it's my thing, man. People are too damn sensitive. Like, come on, this is comedy.
Yeah, but it wasn't, like you said, it was comedy. It had some laughter in it. But for the most part, it was a statement.
It was a statement. It was a statement.
Yeah. Because it started from the DaBaby thing all the way to his friend who put it away. You feel what I'm saying? Dave Chappelle is like, yo, when did this shit become so fucking sensitive like this? You got somebody that was part of your community that y'all made fun of that she killed herself over.
Uh-huh.
And y'all supposed to be together in this? Come on, bro.
No.
That's what I'm saying, man.
The funny thing, Dave was like, I'm a feminist.
Right. Right. You feel what I'm saying? Like, hey, man, I mean, I said a lot, but what's really your whole opinion, Chiz, on this shit?
I think people need to get their panties out a bunch. Like we said, it's freedom of speech in this world. Dave is entitled to say what the hell Dave wants to say. The man is great. You know what I'm saying? And he says stuff that a lot of people do not want to talk about. I think that was the whole purpose for this particular special. He wanted to address the LGBTQT, ABCD, whatever the fuck it is. Don't quote me. But he wanted to address them and the cancel culture also. You know what I'm saying? Like, fuck that. I say what I want to fucking say. And y'all can say y'all gonna cancel me, but hey, my bank account telling a different story.
I mean, really, what the hell is a cancel culture? Who has the right?
Who created that shit?
Right.
That shit sound like bullshit.
Who has the right to tell that? And that's why Snoop said he named his album algorithm. It goes
algorithm.
Because he said it's always some type of computer or some shit that's telling the world that, yeah, you should cancel this person. No, you should let this person do this. Yeah, you feel what I'm saying? Like, at the end of the day, whoever created this cancel culture shit, fuck y'all. I'm going to be honest with you. You can't cancel
In the horse you rode in on.
Right. You can't cancel Diary of the Culture. You can't cancel Bill for this network, because guess what? I played for the team my fucking part on out this bitch. You feel what I'm saying? So, at the end of the day, you ain't canceling shit. You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, but you pick and choose who you want to cancel. This is the whole thing, too. Motherfucker, you got Harvey Weinstein that was doing crazy shit out here, but you're not sitting there saying, oh, cancel everything Harvey Weinstein put his name on. You're not saying that. You're not saying that. You feel what I'm saying? But
or cancel Oprah ass for co-signing that nigga.
Right. But for DaBaby, who had a moment in hip-hop performing, oh, now y'all saying he can't eat. Now all his shows get canceled and everything. Now he can't
put his fucking... Nobody don't want to fuck with him.
Right. But when he go back and start robbing your motherfucking moms and pops, your auntie and everything, you looking at him as a fucking thug. What options are you giving him? The man went from a positive thing to doing the thing. Okay, maybe what he said was fucked up, but the man went on his social media and apologized for what he said. It ain't like he stood on his statement. You feel what I'm saying? He apologized for what he said. And y'all still want a motherfucker to take money out of his pocket? Come on, bro. That shit is crazy to me.
Yeah. It's ridiculous on how they, you know, it's like you gotta walk on eggshells.
Cheers. This, like you said, this the most sensitive ass era we ever been in, bro.
He acting like a little girl.
When you feel like comedians can't be comedians to say what they want to say to bring laughter and knowledge to certain shit, you feel what I'm saying? Like, this was the fact. This was prior Mooney and all these people sat there and paved the way for Chappelle and Eddie Murphy and all these people to be free and say what the fuck they want.
Yeah.
But you want to cancel one of the best comedians we got in the world. Why?
Yeah. Not only that,
but the man is very knowledgeable. See, when you're very knowledgeable and you know what it is and how the world is so fucked up and how you moving out here, and you still got certain people of power who rock with you, guess what? You're a threat to society.
That's what I was about to say. Yeah.
You're a threat to society, bro. For real. Dave Chappelle might not be a billionaire, but he's rich in knowledge. He's rich in knowledge. Yeah, he got some M's in the bank account, but he's also rich in knowledge. What he drops is not only comedy, but he also gives you knowledge. He drops a
game
on you.
And knowledge, too.
Yeah, bro. Yeah.
Because even the minister stood behind him.
And now, see, come on now.
Come on, like, the minister put out a statement standing behind Dave Chappelle.
Yeah, because what Dave Chappelle's saying is the truth.
Exactly.
You're mad at the truth? That's the only reason why you're mad.
Because, man, we live in a world where people don't like to hear the truth.
Right.
People like being said lies.
Right.
People like being bamboozled. That's what it seemed like.
And the crazy part is, this community, who's supposed to be a tight-knit community, is sitting there, you know what I mean? Like, oh, Dave Chappelle was talking about us bad. Why? Because he's telling you something that you shouldn't be doing?
Yeah.
If you didn't like to be judged for who the fuck you was, why you sitting there judging everybody else?
Yeah, and see, they talk mad shit about Black Lives Matter, but nobody gets up and speaks up for that. Nobody get canceled for that.
Come on, man. I'm telling you.
We the motherfuckers went through 400 years of slavery and better.
But we don't. But, we don't.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. This is the gems that Dave Chappelle dropped, bro. Everything you saying, these are the gems Dave Chappelle dropped. And he said wasn't wrong. Don't sit there and
tell
people if you fought to be, have these freedom and rights to be free and not to be judged for who you are and what you want to be and everything. Don't sit there because you're being hypocritical, bro. That's being a hypocrite. You're being fucking 2, 3, 4, 5 faced. You feel what I'm saying?
Being a total dickhead.
That shit is crazy to me, bro.
I don't get it. I get it, but I don't. You know what I mean? Like, it's not fair. Because it seemed like the rules bend for different groups of people.
Man, it does. It totally does. And if you mean by groups of people, meaning white people, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it does.
Yeah.
I never heard not one white person get canceled out this motherfucker.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. The only motherfucker I will co-sign canceling is R. Kelly.
If I'm wrong of any white person being canceled, please tell me in the chat room right now. And I go on the next show and acknowledge it. But, hey, for the most part, us black and brown people, oh, we quit to cancel each other out.
Mm-hmm.
Even if we apologize. Even if in a moment we had a heated moment or in the moment we say some things, but we still go on our platform and apologize, you're still... Mm-hmm. Not even forgiving us. The baby went on his platform and apologized to every last person, the community, the world, everything. And still, y'all wanted to cancel this young brother.
Mm-hmm.
To take food out of his baby mouth.
Yeah.
Feed his family. But again, if he...
And it goes back to what you said before. It's like, would you rather this nigga out on the streets robbing y'all, knocking your grandma upside the head, or making music and entertaining people?
Right.
Pick your poison.
Doing something positive.
Yeah.
Earning something, an honest living.
Yeah.
Come on, man.
That shit, you know what? That shit don't make no sense. It's just straight stupidity. When I think about it, and disgusting.
Yo, it's the worst. It's the worst.
Yeah.
It's like
if you, particularly if you black or brown, you can't say shit. Right. It's like, be quiet.
Right. That's exactly.
The fuck? I got a mouth. I got a mind.
That's exactly what they saying out here, bro.
Yeah,
exactly what they.
And I hate, and you know what? I hate to, you know, make it about race, but it always goes back to race.
It's always gonna be about that, Chiz. It ain't no hate talking about it. It is what it is. Let's keep the cards up. You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah, we gonna call an ace a spade a spade.
Hey, at the end of the day, it's always gonna be about race. Bottom the fuck
always.
Line. Bottom line. Bottom line.
You know what the fucked up thing? They don't even want to teach our kids the proper history of this shit in our school systems. They don't even want to teach them that.
And see, that's why as parents, we need to teach our kids what's going on.
Inform them. Yeah, get them knowledge, game, and jewels. So that way, when they go on, they'll know.
My whole
don't let these folks come out here and tell you what they want to tell you.
My whole thing is, okay, I'm not in the business to judge nobody, because when Judgment Day does happen, God's going to have the last.
It ain't season. Nobody perfect.
Okay? I'm not sitting there telling you who to be with, who to date, who to marry, who to how to dress, what's your preference, and all
whatever floats your boat. That's my thing.
Whatever floats your boat. But also, when it comes to my children, and I'm saying my children,
mm-hmm.
my children are gonna know, okay, you know, originally a girl's supposed to be a girl, a guy's supposed to be a guy. You feel what I'm saying? Bottom line. You know what I mean? Now, when they get old enough to feel like that this is what, you feel what I'm saying? I am, or whatever the case may be. Okay, cool. That's why I don't understand when people say I was born gay. No, you wasn't.
It's learned behavior.
It's something that you saw. You feel
yeah, that's like being a racist.
Right.
It's learned behavior.
It's learned behavior.
Kids are not born like that.
Exactly. You're not born gay. You're not. You wasn't.
It's learned, like you said, something they saw or something they was taught.
Exactly. Exactly. Because that's what kids do. They are knowledgeable. They are observant of everything.
They like sponges.
Right. If you're showing them how to sell crack, guess what they gonna do? They gonna learn how to sell crack. You feel what I'm saying? Hell, for the most part, I knew how to bag up dope when I was 13 from watching my uncles in them. Fuck.
Yeah, it's like they think it's okay because this is what the older folks around them is doing.
Right.
You know what I mean?
I knew.
Like, I raised around mostly all my family did drugs, alcoholics, drug addicts and alcoholics. You know, some of them are recovered, some of them are not. But this is what I seen as a kid. So it's like when it came to like smoking weed, drinking and stuff, you kind of think it's okay.
Right.
Like, you know, I seen Uncle so-and-so do it. I seen Aunt so-and-so. I see Grandmom, you know, over there smoking. So it's, you know, you think it's okay as a child. Because, you know, these are your surroundings.
But at the same time,
you own your product or your environment.
You are.
You know.
You are, but at the same time, you got that aunt and uncle who does get high. What do they tell you? Don't be like me.
Don't be. That's what, yeah, you're right. You're right.
Because I'm doing it, don't you do this. You feel me?
But you know what? As a kid, it goes in one ear out the other. Because if you think as a kid, okay, auntie, you told me not to do it, but you do it. So,
right.
Okay, if you get caught up in a situation, oh, come hit this blunt. You're going to be thinking about it. I know what auntie told me, but hey, fuck it, let me try it.
But see,
you know what I'm saying?
But see, at that point, this is what's missing in the schools today. When we mm-hmm. when we was in school, Chiz, we had the D.A.R.E. program. So
yeah.
we knew
yeah.
with the D.A.R.E. program, and everybody should, if you okay, with the D.A.R.E. program, you knew, okay, auntie, you seen auntie do this, but in school, you told auntie, listen, in school, they taught me that, you know, if you do this, you know, your brain and stuff, you can die from this. So why you do it?
Yeah.
And what your auntie do? Your auntie might cry. Your auntie might tell you because or she'll come up with some type of excuse why she do it. You feel what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Because she always instilling you, you don't do what I do, baby. You be better than me. Auntie got to do this because she whatever. You feel what I'm saying?
And this all goes back to mental health, too, what you was talking about.
Right. Because now that stirs up an anxiety in you as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
So when you grow
mm-hmm.
up, guess what? Sometimes you have that anxiety of what's going on. You feel what I'm
mm-hmm.
saying? Like, real shit. I have an anxiety
yeah.
when it comes to needles, because guess what? Streets might grab. The streets might grab you. You might start gang banging, drug dealing, robbing, doing whatever you're doing. But you'll always know right for fucking wrong. You've seen people who died. You've seen people who go to jail. You've seen these people. So you, it ain't like you not up on game to know what's right as what's wrong. You feel what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Now it
becomes common sense.
Right. It becomes a choice that you stepped in it because of what? And again, I don't know people's situations. Some people do it just to feed their family. Some people do it just for the thrill. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I don't know your circumstances.
Because mostly everybody that I know that sell drugs, they do it because of survival reasons. Like you said, they got to feed their family.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, is this really wrong or is this right? Like, it's kind of a blurred line.
It's wrong.
You know, it's like they doing the right thing with the money, but they, you know, they killing people. People
at
are suffering
time,
because
right.
of these drugs that's,
right.
you know, that they're buying and putting in their body.
And guess what? Now this becomes...
Kids are being put in foster homes because these parents get strung out and could no longer take care of them. Or better yet, even take care of themselves.
Okay, but now it becomes a thing of opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
It becomes a thing of opportunity. Because, yeah, we could go out and create our own opportunity. Granted, we could go out and grind and hustle. We could do 4 years of college, 8 years of college. But guess what? You might have a master's degree in whatever your major in. Doesn't mean you're going to have that same job that you got your degree in. So now, at the end of the day, where's your opportunity at this point? I just did 8 years and getting my doctorate on something, but I'm still sitting in this fucking cubicle right here. So what the fuck I go to school for?
And you owe a whole bunch of student loans.
You feel what I'm saying? What did I go to school for? At the end of the day, that's what I'm saying.
You in debt. You in debt, probably working at McDonald's, Burger King.
With
a college degree.
Right. You can create our opportunity, granted, but we also don't get no opportunity either. You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We sit there and knock on these doors. That's why I said, motherfuckers that get locked up and shit, guess what? You can sit here and say, yo, you know, second chance, rehabilitate. But what's the odds of that person getting the second chance, man?
Mm-hmm.
What's the odds? Now, let's keep it all the way 100. This brother done... This brother done did a crime, learned his lesson while doing his time, but picked up a trade, got maybe a degree in jail and whatever the case may be, came out to implement that degree, but guess what's holding him back? The fact that he has a history and a record. So guess what society tells us? Oh, you might get a judge to go out and be productive. That's all they, that's what they say, right? Go out and be productive to society. You know, you got a second chance on life. Try to make it happen.
But how can you when you're getting doors closed on you? You want to go back to your old habits.
You're judged by your cover. You're judged.
Mm-hmm.
You're not even judged by the situation of a person talking to you to give you the opportunity. You're judged based on, okay, this motherfucker had a robbery. He served 12 years. Oh, shit. I don't know if he's going to rob me or not or whatever the case
is. Yeah, they deem him untrustworthy at that point.
Because, okay, and now guess what? Now you got probation or parole telling you you need to get a job.
Yeah, you're going to get locked back up if you don't.
If we talk, like you said, if we talking about bamboozle, this is where the bamboozle comes in at. Because you might make parole or whatever after doing a certain amount of years. Now, parole tell you, yo, you got to go out and find a job. How the fuck you supposed to go out and find a job you just did 10 to 12 years and you don't even have a work history like that. You feel what I'm saying?
Second, yeah.
That's why
I like $1 Million Worth of Game. Wallo did 20 years in prison. He always say 5 minutes of doing the wrong shit cost me 20 years. And when he got out, he didn't wait for nobody to give him no job. He said, I started selling t-shirts. He said, I started coming up my own brand.
But that's,
like, believing in myself.
Right. But he has to have a backing to do that. You feel what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't no
He said, I was hustling t-shirts. He said, I was sleeping on my grandma's couch. And he said, I wake up 6-7 o'clock every day, go out, sell my t-shirts, you know, make enough, give me some food, stack the rest of my money up. Next day, do the same thing.
But see,
you know, and look where he at. You know, pretty successful now.
But that was his plan. He already had that set in his mind. You feel what
I'm saying?
Let's just
his mindset.
Right.
His mindset was on point.
Right. So let's just say if Wallo wanted to present one of his t-shirts to a designing company, would you give a Wallo that type of opportunity? Would a person give that? Maybe on the level of we talk about now because it's independency, maybe so.
But back then, because he got a name now.
Oh, man, yeah. But
he got a name now. He rubbed elbows with different people.
Bruh, at the end of the day.
But back then, no. I think that's why he had to go out and basically create his own lane.
But this is what I'm saying. Parole, when you go on parole, is the fuckery. Because they send you out there in the slums knowing you ain't got a motherfucking resume to motherfucker present a motherfucker. But they give you a certain amount of time to try to find a job. How the fuck?
And then everything is a violation. You could jaywalk. That's a violation.
This is what I'm saying. So now, let's include that. So now you only got a certain amount of time out the day to go and find a job. Then you got to check in or be home. You can't be around certain people and or whatever, alcohol environment, other criminals or whatever. So now that's a motherfucker, another anxiety. Because now the people that might be a family member that you gathered with got a fucking record, but guess what? I'm in violation because I'm around my uncle and he's a felon.
Yeah, he is a felon. Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
So now I'm in violation.
I think that whole probation system, the whole fucking prison system is meant to entrap you.
Yeah. It's fucked up.
Yeah.
It's fucked up, bro.
Especially if you, all right, say this situation, a person do a crime. Maybe it's their first crime. Let's say that. They get them 5-6 years probation. I think that's bullshit.
Bro. So
I heard situations where motherfuckers get 10 years probation.
Right.
What the fuck? It's like you locked up, but you're not.
And it goes back, like you said, to Wallo. Wallo got a 20 to damn near 50 years. He did.
Yeah, 20, he did 20.
And now he's still on probation or parole for the rest of his fucking life?
I think he got off probation.
Bruh, it's just crazy, though. But that is fucking crazy.
Because he had to put his time in. I guess he decided, I'm going to do my time.
So now,
you know,
but
I'm going to sit.
Okay, so now, like you said, if a motherfucker got 20 years, he do 10, get out on 10, and fuck on good behavior.
He's still
fucked
up.
He's walking on fucking eggshell for the rest of his 10-year career.
I'd rather do the 20. I don't want to do no 10, and you put me out on 10-year probation. Nah, I just sit. I sit.
That shit is crazy. It's, like you said.
If God allows me to live through this, to be able to tell my story, hey, it is what it is.
It's designed.
But you're not going to have me on no 10-year probation.
Yeah. And no,
that's bullshit.
Bruh, how can you? You don't even know what the next 5 years of that gonna hold on you.
Yeah, especially with all this shit from the cops harassing black folks, black men, black women, any minority. You know what I'm saying? You could blink at them wrong, and they ready to throw the cuffs on you. And you know what? That's a violation. Send you back to the big house.
Bro.
It's a fucked up world we live in.
It's crazy, man. It really is, bro.
This shit all goes back to slavery, too. This is modern-day slavery.
All the way, bro. All the way.
Even police. If all y'all do y'all history about police, police started from slave patrols.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's how they created police.
Shit is...
Because they always got... They always... has to keep their thumb over us. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Man.
They always have to have some type of control over us.
Yeah,
Because as black people, minorities, we are the alpha race.
And always gonna be.
Always gonna be. It's never gonna change. That's why they try to kill us. That's why they rape our woman. They try to murder our woman. You know, they kidnapping our kids. You know, they want our organs.
Yeah,
human trafficking.
Yeah,
this shit's fucked up.
It's real fucked up.
Don't mean to get all deep, but hey, y'all, we got, you know, we all gotta be in tune with all of this. Because this is the world that's happening. And you want to know what's happening in the world. You just don't want to be in your bubble.
Hey, man, listen, speak how you feel, mean what you say, and say what the fuck you mean.
Yes, sir.
You feel what I'm saying? Bottom line.
Yes,
yo,
sir.
We got to get up out of here, man. I know we're up here rambling, but, you know, this is stuff. We going to be back on track daily with these shows, y'all. You feel what I'm saying? Like I said, again, we go do life situations as well. We human and everything else, so we go through life situations where we have to, you know, push a lot of shows back, but we back on track with it, and we're gonna continue to give you this content.
We keep it trucking, you know. It ain't all perfect, but you know, we keep it trucking.
Make sure y'all check out consistent programming throughout the Built for This network platform. And remember to go to builtforthisradionetwork@gmail.com or if you are an interested podcaster or DJ. You feel what I'm saying? Hit your boy up, Chief up, A-Trap up. You know what I mean? Hit me up at Matt_Knox201 on that Instagram, at Illmatic Beats on that Twitter. You feel what I'm saying? I got the crowned in 1983 album out now. This is my fifth. I call it an EP, but it's an album, I guess, to certain people.
Well, I would say it's project, man, because, you know, it's kind of a blurred line between EPs and LPs. So I just would say project.
Yeah. But this is my fifth one. I got my sixth one, Energy and Volumes, Hear What I Do, coming out on Christmas Day, featuring your boy Chiz Roundtree on the intro. You feel what I'm saying? On the poetry.
Chief called me. Chief said the poet.
Yeah. On the poetry of things. You feel what I'm saying? So go and remember, I got Summers of August 14th, okay? I got X-Ray Visions of Music. I got Beat Speak When Lyrics Don't, an instrumental love story. I got Midnight Infinite Soul. I got Crowned It in 1983. Come on, man. Go out and purchase
them. That's a hell of a catalog.
Go out and purchase them on any streaming platform right now. Support your boy. I got babies I need to feed. You feel what I'm saying? So don't stream one or two songs. Just purchase the album. You feel what I'm saying? If you could spend $10 on liquor, on a backwood, on a bag of weed, on whatever you could spend $10
on your stogies and your bogies.
You feel what I'm saying? You could spend $10 for your boy to feed his babies. You feel what I'm saying? Because like I said, I work for them. I'm the CEO. They the owners. You feel what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
That's how I move my life. Like, my kids are the owners. I'm just the CEO and president. You feel what I'm saying? I work for them. So remember to check out all the YouTube page, the End of the Bench. Check out DJ Mukadeng on that Twitch. If you download that Twitch app, follow In The Zone Entertainment. You know what I mean? DJ Mukadeng be rocking on the Fridays from 6 to 8. You get that visual. Mukadeng on the ones and twos. Go support our Build For This Network brother. You feel what I'm saying? Go support the End of the Bench podcast as well on that YouTube. Subscribe and hit that notification bell when you get all the episodes. Shout out to the brother H-Rap B. Shout out to Chief Rocker. He gonna be back real, real soon. He's still rocking. So, I mean, but he's gonna be into his real form real, real soon. You feel what I'm saying? So, shout out to him.
And yeah, salute to all the brothers, man.
Entertainment show.
And the sisters.
Shout out, right, to Purplicious. Shout out to the Noise. You know what I mean? Just remember, go to Built For This Radio on that YouTube channel. Like and subscribe that Front Ground Records. Like and subscribe as well. You feel what I'm saying? Timeless Music Group for my man Earl Jones. ENT Productions as well for Earl Jones. You know what I mean? What we got, Chiz? The Chiz.
And be in tune. Be in tune for a lot of future stuff happening.
Yeah, me.
We got a lot of plans that we cannot release right now. But, you know, everybody will be in tune with it soon, pretty soon.
Yo,
you know, a lot of new things. 2022 is coming.
We're going to, real soon, we're going to put up the Me, Myself, and Chiz album on streaming platforms.
Yeah.
You feel what I'm saying? Real
soon. And we need everybody to show up and show out and support.
And support that, for real. You can check out the album on YouTube. I'm bigging up everybody else YouTube. But I have a YouTube channel as well. Y'all go in y'all search engine on YouTube and type in Mad Knox. Guess what? All my albums is up there. You feel what I'm saying? So the people...
Mm-hmm.
I want y'all to still go and purchase the album. Don't
they get a little preview. A little preview on YouTube.
But my
thing is, and then they go and purchase it after that.
Go and purchase it. Thank you. Download these records and put it in your phone. You feel me? So in the meantime, between time, you know,
I'm gonna tell y'all, man puts a lot of hard work, dedication, patience, sacrifice into what is happening.
Real hard work.
Yeah.
Real hard work. Hard work. I really do, man. I love what I do. You know what I mean? I do it for the love, but like H-Rap said, now we got to do it for the love of money. You know what I mean?
So,
at the end of the day, hey, man, listen, like I said before, I got kids, man. I work for them. I'm the CEO. They the owners. I want to provide and bring money home to them. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So, at the end of the day, help your boy out, man. Like Chiz said, I put a lot of hard work, mental hours, mixing down.
Patience, dedication.
You know what I mean? Just to give y'all a couple of soundtracks so y'all can vibe to and go do life with. You feel what I'm saying? So, you know, support your boy. Oh, man. Is we forgetting
the and that's giving roses, man.
Hey,
that's giving roses.
Is we forgetting anything else, my brother?
Nah, I think we good, man. God bless and everybody. You know, be safe out here.
Yeah, definitely. Wear masks. Get vaccinated if you want to. If not, get tested weekly. But wear masks. Wash your hands. Wash your ass. go out with some dignity and some class. You feel what I'm saying? It's been a blast. Your boy, DJ Mad Knox, Cheers Roundtree, built for this network. Stay blessed, not stressed. You already know the rest. God's will, we see y'all next week. Peace.
Deuces.
Lots of jewels and stuff, backyards with swimming pools, bars with stools and stuff, fancy foods, lobster, sushi, yeah, Versace, Gucci, crazy Lucci. I know your MO, you do demo on a paycheck. You get a herb from the bourbon, show them no respect. Middle name, price tag, first name, gotcha. Started slow, got on a roll, now they can't stop ya. Talking about, hey boo, how you do? Some clown uptown said you ran through a screw. I give you bucks and your credit cause it's due, but I ain't that clown and my crew ain't that crew. Time's too hard to be faking like I'm dating on some staking, whining and dining, I ain't tricking on no chicken. Leave it up to me, I close the whole damn store on ya. I got nothing but love for ya.
I got nothing but love for ya, baby.
What you got?
I got nothing but love for ya, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I got nothing but love for ya, baby.
Uh-huh.
I got nothing but love for ya, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I got nothing but love for ya, baby.
What you got?
I got nothing but love for ya, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I got nothing but love for ya, baby.
Uh-huh.
I got nothing but love for ya, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I'm not your H-E-R-B, but I'm your H-E-A-V. Why dash D? Don't test me. Don't ask me for nothing. For Nathan's, for Jack, for Doodly Squad. You can do me not. You plan on plotting on who be hot and trying to hit the slot. I know your low pro style, your low ho profile. Kick a brother in the gut and then you smile. I must admit, I really dig your operation. Every time we on the phone, you got the sexy conversation. So now you hope to be the woman of my dream. And while I'm sleeping, you be creeping, robbing me clean. I see you hanging on the corners with the rest of your girl crew. Standing by the gutter with your booty cutters. So who's the honey dip? Down with the bunny grip. Always got a plan and a scam to get some money quick. Always getting with the next man, the one with the checks and setting up the trap with the sex.
Yeah.
I got nothing but love for you, baby.
What you got?
I got nothing but love for you, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I got nothing but love for you, baby.
Uh-huh.
I got nothing but love for you, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I got nothing but love for you, baby.
What you got?
I got nothing but love for you, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I got nothing but love for you, baby.
Uh-huh.
I got nothing but love for you, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
No bother, don't know about that. This the jumper, yo. Don't know about that. Don't know about that. This the jumper, yo. Don't know about that. Don't know about that. This the jumper,
yo. You are now tuned in to your number one radio station.
Built for this network.
You give me feelings like I'm dealing with a crooked hand. You got a grin from a man because you shook his hand. You well known in the streets and the gutters. So fly when you caught my eye, you made me stutter. You come around with your curls and your pretty pearls. Even been around the world, so you go, girl. But where's the love at? Tell me where's the hugs at? Acting like a rug rat. I know where you bug that. Don't try to gas me, girl. I know the streets well. You're money hungry and you make a trick or treat sell. So leave it up to me. I close the whole damn store on you. I got nothing but love for you.
I got nothing but love for you, baby. What you got?
I got nothing but love for you, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I got nothing but love for you, baby.
Uh-huh.
I got nothing but love for you, honey.
We are built for this network. For the strong, not the weak.